An endangered species, you and me. In an era of downsizing and eliminating our beloved internal combustion engines, we rebel. We strive for passion, perfection, and ingenuity. We strive for something greater. Soul. During the time when all car manufacturers are changing their ways and electrifying their brands, we look back at what made cars alive. We look back at what once was, fading away as the clock ticks. This is a love letter to the artistry of car manufacturing. A love letter to what helps us get closer to our dreams, what lets us experience them as closely as possible. Racing games. GT4 needs no introduction, for it is considered to be the single greatest racing title ever made. As close to perfection as any studio ever came to, and perhaps even reached it. The only flaws the game possesses are the shackles of the sixth generation. A masterpiece unleashed. Even now, almost two decades later, it is a benchmark to which all simcade racing titles are judged against. Obviously, none ever come close. Sit back, grab a drink, and relax as I dive deep into Gran Turismo 4 and explain exactly why it is racing game royalty. There is not much to say about the production process, since Polyphony used to be incredibly secretive about it. The game was delayed for over a year and a half, and as an apology from PD, the fans got GT4 Prologue, which features around 50 cars from the game to be, and 5 tracks. Prologue ditches the GT mode and instead has Driving School. From what I can tell, they are pretty much license tests with a different name. There seems to be no AI either, rather peculiar. There is an ungodly amount of content, 721 cars, over 50 tracks. To put it into perspective, it takes over 300 hours to 100% the game. With 530 races ready to be won, it is no surprise, however. It features over 80 manufacturers, albeit notably lacking Porsche, Bugatti, and the two most iconic supercar manufacturers, Ferrari and Lamborghini, three of which were new additions to the franchise in the next installment. The car list ranges over 120 years, the oldest car being the Mercedes-Benz patent Motorwagen. For their time, the models were meticulously detailed and one of the best on the market, if not the best. These models will go on to get upscaled and used as standard cars in GT5 and GT6 respectively. The game features 16 endurance races, some of which are the 24 Hours of Le Mans, Nürburgring 24 Hours, 1000 kilometers of Suzuka, and 9 Hours of Tacuba. These are not hugely rewarding in terms of money earned, however, they are the only ways to earn certain vehicles, such as the Bentley Speed A and the Calsonic R32 Skyline. They push the very limits of the PS2 system, with a notable absence of a daylight cycle and the weather changes most likely caused by the constraints of the console itself. Truly a shame that neither Gran Turismo 6 nor 7 feature it. Do note that GT7 is supposed to get endurance races sometime in the future. Long story short, the content of this game is simply unmatched. So much to do, yet the game has your attention for most of it. Incredible achievement. GT4 is energetic, yet simultaneously keeps a calm and therapeutic tone throughout its entire playtime. It is a clean and precise car museum that lets you buckle up and joyride those machines. An absolute masterclass in game design. Every little bit of the game is handcrafted to absolute perfection. Flaws are few and far between. Entering a race gives you an experience simply unmatched by any other game, both in its very series and other franchises as well. There is not much to say about the presentation. It is amazing. Epochal, even. Ask any GT fan what perfectly fits it all together, they will answer by saying how it is the easily the most iconic racing game soundtrack of all time. GT4 does not miss in this metric either. The fusion jazz used is just god tier. GT mode lounge music is something truly special. It is perfect in every regard, and nothing can change my mind about it. It speaks volumes about the sheer quality of the OST that is still used to this day, mostly in YouTube videos, however. Notice the song playing right now? Yes, it's from GT4. The arcade race theme is magnificent, flawless, iconic, the most recognizable song from the entire OST, and that is saying something. The in-race song list is full of amazing tunes as well, no doubt about it. The game isn't ideal, and the cynic in me would say nothing is. However, even the flaws of GT4 are so minute they don't ruin the experience much, if at all. There are three main flaws: the licenses, of which there are too many, the damage model, or lack thereof, and the fact that assists are forced upon you per default, and to disable them you have to do it manually on every car. License counts just equate to boredom. I'll cover this later. Car damage isn't a deal breaker and doesn't really ruin the experience at all. The assists, however, really are an issue. It's strange to see such a massive oversight present in this meticulously crafted game. GT mode was at its zenith with GT4. So much to do that you simply get lost, in an ideal way. From the Sunday Cup to rally events, race cars and super trucks, in both A-spec and B-spec, which was a new addition to this legendary franchise. A-spec is the mode in which you test your skills as a world-class driver, whilst B-spec flexes your ability to manage the role of team principal. B-spec lets you speed up the race by up to 3 times, rather useful for endurance races. Coupled with the game's amazing handling and physics model, these events are a joy to beat, unlike the license tests. The game features an all-time high of 80 license tests, with the usual format of NA, NB, IA, IB, and Super licenses. It introduces coffee breaks as well, which are surprisingly frustrating. The licenses are just a snooze fest due to the sheer number of them. What the licenses lack is variety. They tend to repeat each other, with the only difference being the track and car used. This is made right by the inclusion of the Mission Stadium. It packs incredibly fun challenges to beat all the ones of the same variety, and you get a unique reward. At their core, they are relatively similar, however the difference is how punishing they are. Hit a car in a mission? No big deal. Do it in a license test? There go the 2 minutes of your life spent chasing the pace car. Incredibly frustrating. All basic events are split into 3 categories, beginner, professional, and extreme. These split up the challenge and require you to finish a certain amount of events to participate in them. Special conditioned events are usually a 1v1 on a random surface, whether that is snow, sand, gravel, or asphalt. If you hit the walls or your opponent, you get a 5-second penalty, which you serve by being forced off the throttle for that time period. These give you amazing cars worth a decent chunk of money, which you can redo to your heart's content and hoard those cars. Alternatively, you can sell the prize cars. I recommend doing the George V Rally Medium for over 350k, or the Capri Rally Easy for a car worth 270k. Incredibly game-breaking in the early game, great fun too. It lets you progress through the GT mode much quicker and gives you the ability to buy expensive race cars within a few hours of gameplay. If this is what you want to do, I highly suggest you do it only after beating the game normally. All manufacturers have their own Manufacturer's Cup, which features cars from their lineup racing each other under certain entry rules. These typically pay out handsomely and give you a unique car from the manufacturer to enjoy. For example, the M3 GTR road car is won by winning the Club M Championship. The game also features 3 event halls based on the origin country or continent of your car: the European, Japanese, and American event halls. These have events that can only be entered with cars from those countries. As always, they dish out handsome rewards. Upon reaching 25% game completion, the Endurance Hall is unlocked. It lets you participate in endurance races, obviously. The game can be a drag at times, especially at the start when it's not challenging and rather mundane. It does severely pick up the pace later on, so sticking with it is highly recommended. Arcade mode features single race, 2-player, LAN mode, and time trial. These don't really need to be explained as they are present in every racing game ever made. The car selection consists of certain cars from each manufacturer. Unfortunately, I don't think you can drive every car in arcade mode. You can, however, drive on every track in the game after unlocking it in Gran Turismo mode. Cars feel very well balanced and have a unique feeling of weight to them. There tends to be a lot of understeer, which is unusual for SimCade racing games, as they usually go for the oversteer and power slide focused approach. It is always a breath of fresh air to drive cars that feel planted and have rear end grip, at least to a realistic degree. It is highly up to preference, but I am not a fan of most SimCades in which you just power slide through half of the corners, as is evident by my last review of GT5 as well. In numerous comparison tests done by Top Gear and other automotive journalists, the cars in GT4 were roughly 10 seconds a lap faster than in real life. However, a large portion of this time was attributed to the lack of danger, letting the driver push much harder. This is, however, important to mention. Jeremy Clarkson gave the game a 3 out of 5, praising it for realism, citing how there are certain corners the Bentley Speed 8 takes in real life flat out, and if the driver lifts there, isn't enough downforce for the car to make the corner. He also commented on the fact that the brakes on the M3 CSL are nowhere near as strong in the game as they are in real life. I was surprised when I found out that it existed, however setting it up nowadays is a tad bit tricky. I could not get it to work on my PC, so I cannot say much about it that wasn't from the internet. It was the first time the PP system appeared in Gran Turismo, quite interesting. It is surprisingly fleshed out for a beta version. If you're playing this by emulating it through PCSX2, you have native wheel support in the newest build. This was possible for a while, however it was a frustrating process to set up with plugins. I highly recommend playing this game on a wheel as it offers the best experience. Words fall short of describing Polyphony's magnum opus, a game so outlandishly perfect that nothing ever came close to it, the pinnacle of racing games with so few flaws you won't even notice them, a true gem of the genre, a title that knows no bounds. If you haven't played GT4, you're missing out on one incredible experience, a game that created childhoods without a story mode, one that unifies you with your beloved machine. A title in which everything fits in perfectly to create a legend. I hope now you realize why GT4 really is racing game royalty. This video was a blast to make and I'd really appreciate it if you were to like and subscribe. It means a lot. The GT5 video was my foray into these waters. I'm glad to see it did so well. Thank you for your support, viewer.